So today we're talking about save rows. For a developer, saving rows is easily B's most intimidating feature. It requires multiple steps to configure. It also requires the use of a content dialog, and it requires the use of asynchronous JavaScript. However, today I hope to show you that saving rows isn't too difficult. It's one of those things that looks much more complicated than it is. So in the next 10 minutes, I'm going to walk you through coding a fully functional saved rows implementation, complete with edit and delete management. First, we'll install B plugin using our official NPM package. Next, we'll implement the saved rows code. And then finally, I'll show you how to disable saved rows on a per user basis. Full disclosure, we've coded a few parts in advance. As the name implies, saving rows has a storage component. So if we want to reuse rows in the future, we need to put them somewhere. So for the purpose of this demo, we're going to use a simple mocked API to simulate a database. Additionally, we've imported a generic modal window component and some simple user text inputs to capture the input from the end user. The parts that you won't see today took about 20 minutes to prepare, and you'll have the opportunity to review these in our GitHub repository after the webinar. So let's look at the project that we have on the screen. This is a simple React app. I created this with a tool called Create React App to generate this project. We did this before the demo because it takes about 5 to 10 minutes to download the libraries. But the only difference between this stock app that you're looking at now and the one created with Create React App is that we added a logo. And we also imported some of those pre-built components that we talked about earlier. Okay, so the project's ready to go. So let's get into the code. First, we're going to install B plugin, and I'm going to go through this rather quickly so we can focus more on the rows. The first thing we want to do is import our B plugin official NPM package. Next, we're going to import everybody's favorite template, the Hackister. And the next thing we're going to need is our client ID and secret. Note that if this was a real app, you'd want to create your token on the server. It's really important to keep these credentials secured. For the demo, we've included them in an environment file. The next thing we need is a bare minimum B configuration. The minimum requirements for B configuration is only a UID, which is just some text string to represent the user, and the name of the container. So let's go ahead and add our container. And I'm just going to swap out this logo with our B plugin container. Okay, last but not least, we need the start code to start the editor. Okay, so the code that you see inside of this, what's called a use effect, this is just how you do things in React. You put your code into an effect, but the code that's inside is going to be the same in any type of JavaScript application. You're going to create an instance of B plugin, get your token, and then finally you pass in your B config and your template into the start method. That's it. So let's save this and make sure it runs. Okay, perfect. We've loaded up our Hackister template. Now the B plugin is installed, let's go ahead and import everything else we're going to need for implementing our saved rows. Okay, so as you can see on the comments on the screen, we're importing a mock API to simulate a database. We're importing a user input control, and we're importing some generic modal components so that we can display a pop-up and let the user input some information. So now that we've imported our mock database, we can actually use that inside of our app. So I'm going to go ahead and pull those into the app. And you'll see that we have some useful methods like get rows and open modal that we'll be using later. Lastly, before we get into the save rows configuration, we need to add our modal component to the stage. I'm gonna insert this directly below the B plugin. And just note it pulls in a property called modals, which comes from our mock backend. Okay, that's all of our requirements. So now we can go ahead and implement our save rows code. The first thing we want to do is implement an event handler so that we can handle the click event when somebody clicks on this save row icon. And the way we're going to do that is with a content dialog. So I'm going to paste a content dialog directly into our bconfig. So let's take a minute and talk about what this is doing. When the save row click event is triggered, B plugin temporarily gives control to the host application. The host app can either return the name of the row immediately, or it can display a modal window so that the end user can enter it. But the only requirement is the host app must call the resolve method and return the name of the row to B plugin. Next, let's add a callback. So once that row is saved, we can get that row back from B plugin. So we're going to use our on save row callback. You can see here that we're simply saving the JSON file to our mock database so that we can reload it later in the side panel. So let's go ahead and set that up so that we can reload this. We're going to use what's called a rows configuration. And here you can see we're using a newer feature called isLocal. This lets B know that the rows are going to be fed back into B plugin through a hook instead of a remote URL. Okay, so let's go ahead and add that hook. So you'll see, just like all of the other callbacks, this is a handler that has a resolve, reject, and arguments. In the arguments, you will receive the handle that was defined in the rows configuration. That's how you know which rows to return back to B plugin. For the purpose of this demo, we're going to return all of the rows via our mock API method called getRows. At this point, saved rows are ready to go. But let's go one step further and add rows management. This is really easy. We only need two new content dialog methods. First, I'll add the delete method. I'll add that right below our save row content dialog. You'll notice here, once again, we have the same signature with resolve, reject, and arguments. And now I'll add the edit row. Now, edit row has more code. It's probably more code than we need. So let me explain. When editing a row, it's possible to return a warning, an error, or a success. So once we get the results back from the modal window, we check to see which type of response we need to send back to B plugin. The minimum requirement would be this bit of code here. And it would look something like this if you wanted to implement the minimum. But let's go back and we'll leave all of the three options in the code. That's it. So let me go ahead and save this and we can try it out. Okay, I'll save the first row. call this our header row. In the next row, our hero row. And then when I go to the rows tab, we see our rows configuration category saved rows. And when I click on this, I get those rows that I just saved. Let's say that I want to delete the header. This is going to trigger that content dialog we added at the end. And if I want to edit this row, we'll trigger that content dialog for edit rows, and then I can change the name here. And you'll see that name is reflected back in Beef plugin. Now, one more thing before we go to questions, I want to show you how to modify what is accessible on a per user basis. So the first thing we can do is we can lock the rows, and we do this through an additional parameter in the config called save rows, and we set that to false. Additionally, we can add a advanced permission to directly to the rows configuration to apply some behaviors. In this case, we are setting can edit to true and can delete to false. So I'll save this and we can see what it looks like. Okay, so when I click on this row, you can see there's no save icon because I don't have that permission. And if I go back into my saved rows category, you'll see that I'm only allowed to edit this row.